The Mongol Empire was the largest contiguous empire in human history. It sprung up into power from a union of all the Mongol clans to dominating nearly all of Eurasia in less than a century. However, as quickly as it rose, it also fell, lasting in total from 1206 to 1368. So, what kind of an impact did this massive but short-lived empire have on human history? The Mongol Empire was one of the most powerful entities in world history, and even though the empire didn't last long before someone broke it, it still left a lasting legacy that we still see around the world to this day. I mean, think about it. There was an empire stretching from Hainan to Hungary, from Tonkin to Turkey, and from Beijing to Busan. Okay, that last one probably wasn't the best example, but you get the idea. The Mongol Empire was, as Overly Sarcastic Productions puts it, stupidly big. What I mean by this is that territory currently controlled by nearly 30 different countries was under the authority of one giant empire, which made things like trade incredibly easy all of a sudden. This makes sense. After all, it can be hard to transport people and goods across borders, and no one entity could police the whole of the Silk Road trade networks. In other words, if Europe and China ever wanted to trade, there were various kingdoms in southwestern Asia who could have called the final shots on that. Okay, first some history. For the longest time, China had been threatened by tribes to the north of their border, who they called the Xiongnu, and would therefore do whatever it took to not be conquered by these guys. You know that pretty big, fairly decent wall that now attracts tourists from all around the world? Yep, it was to keep out the Xiongnu. There was a reason it was built on what was then the northern border. However, when they weren't diverting energy and resources to building a giant wall, they were diverting money to pay different tribes to go to war with each other, in a kind of divide and conquer scenario but without the conquering. Thus, anyone who tried to unite the Mongols would quickly be seen as a national security risk and be captured and executed. Then came a man named Temujin, who, after a series of fights and clever tactics that made him quite popular amongst the people of the tribes he conquered, was declared the Khan of all the Mongol people. Not to be confused with the Canubis, that's a very different thing. You all know the Khan I'm talking about though, Genghis Khan, and yes, I'm pronouncing it the Mongolian way. Following the unification of the Mongol people, Genghis Khan quickly started to wage war against more and more neighboring kingdoms, and blah blah blah. Just watch the extra credits series if you want to actually see how this all happened. I'm just talking about what happened after his empire fell. Then, by the year 1279, Genghis Khan and his descendants had established an empire stretching from St. Petersburg to Shenzhen, from Fujian to- I'm just kidding, I'm not doing this again. The reason why Genghis Khan and the Mongol Empire are so controversial, though, is because these conquests resulted in the deaths of anywhere from 20 to 40 million people, about 5% of the world's population at the time. This is a death toll so high that the carbon levels in the atmosphere actually fell by a noticeable amount, with over 700 million tons of carbon scrubbed from the atmosphere. Well, maybe that's the solution to climate change. However, once this empire had been established, it became relatively easy to trade and transmit goods and ideas across the empire. In fact, a common saying throughout the empire about this newfound safety and stability along the trade routes was, quote, "A maiden bearing a nugget of gold on her head could wander safely throughout the realm." The Mongols even moved people from different cultures and professions around to advance cultural and scientific understanding in different areas of their realm. Religion was also famously widely tolerated under the Mongol leadership, possibly largely because the Mongols knew that their religion was tied strongly to the steppe, where none of their newfound subjects came from, and so didn't exactly expect them to convert to their religion. This period of stability was known as the Pax Mongolica, and would last all throughout the empire's short lifespan. The Mongols also reportedly brought gunpowder to Europe, soon after it was invented in China. In fact, gunpowder was a key ingredient in the Ottoman siege of Constantinople in 1453, so I guess you could say that the true fall of the Roman Empire was brought on indirectly by some guy in Mongolia, as with the Protestant Reformation. In short, while the Mongols didn't exactly do many sciences themselves, they did bring together all the different cultures of their realm and help continue the spread of new technologies and ideas throughout it. However, another thing the Mongol Empire arguably helped spread was the Black Plague. The plague had already started earlier in northern China, but now, with people moving around suddenly more freely than they had been before, the plague found an easy route around Asia and into Europe. There are stories about the Mongols themselves suffering from the plague and throwing the corpses of the diseased comrades into the walls of the city of Kaffa in 1346 as a form of early biological warfare, with the plague then accidentally spreading throughout Europe via Genoese merchants there who decided that they didn't really want to stay there much longer after the fact. However, I take this with a grain of salt. Just a grain, because these accounts were written 100 years after this had allegedly taken place, and the accounts were about as well sourced as a typical Canubis video. Death and disease weren't the only legacy of the Mongol Empire among the populations of Europe and Asia, though. There was also the genetic impact. Genghis Khan was a very prolific man, having had as many as 11 children in his life, with those children going on to, of course, have more children themselves. Genetic analysis has revealed that around 16 million men, about 0.5% of the world's male population, has a Y chromosome inherited from Genghis Khan himself. I mean, this might also be true with women as well, but biological women don't generally tend to have Y chromosomes, so that's kind of harder to check, but still. In short, the Mongol Empire obviously had a massive impact on world history, arguably changing the course of most of Asian history in the latter half of the second millennium. However, much like the empire founded by Alexander the Great nearly 2,000 years prior, the Mongol Empire didn't exactly last very long before it broke up. The empire was divided into four by the year 1300, and these Khanates themselves would go on to start and influence new empires. Genghis Khan has left an interesting influence on world history, though. Depending on who you ask, he was either a nation builder, he united most of a continent, or a tyrant who caused a little bit of death and destruction. I fall a bit more towards the middle, but it's important to remember people and events from history for everything both good and bad that came from them and their achievements. It just depends on how many of those achievements were good or bad. Thank you as always for watching. By the way, for the next few weeks, I will be going on a trip throughout 5 different cities in East Asia and Australia. So if you want to meet up or suggest something for me to do in the cities I'll be going to, feel free to get in touch through email or social media. And I will see you next week from Hong Kong.